We have a 62-year-old male, Mr. ABC, who hails from Suntikoppa, Madikeri, and works as a in a coffee estate. He has received no formal education and has a monthly income of Rs. 2,000. He belongs to the socio-economic status of lower middle class, according to B.G. Prasad. The history is given by him.
Okay, monthly income of 2,000. Okay, anyway, it's okay. We'll go ahead. We'll not discuss about that. Okay, fine. Now, what is the minimum wages in India now? Minimum daily wages?
No,
no. No issue. We'll go ahead.
The history was given by himself and his wife, which is reliable. He is a right-handed individual.
Done.
He presents with the chief complaints of weakness of left upper limb and left lower limb since 4 days, slurred speech since 4 days, deviation of angle of mouth to the right since 4 days.
Okay. Now, I just wanted to highlight here. So, just weakness. Now, what do you mean by, really mean by weakness?
So he wasn't able to lift his left upper limb.
Then you can simply say that he is unable to use his left upper limb and lower limb because of the weakness.
Okay.
Okay. And what do you mean by slurring of speech? Slurred speech? Difficulty in?
Speaking. His words were not audible.
Fine. Okay, fine. Deviation of the mouth. Okay, fine. We'll go ahead.
A known hypertensive patient on medication, non-compliant, presents with weakness in the left upper limb and lower limb.
1 second, Aishwarya.
Yes.
Now, I just wanted to interrupt in this stage. Now, for the typical UG examination, I would like to explain you to explain whatever you have mentioned, whatever the blah blah blah, whatever we say, the known hypertension, I would like to present it in the medical history or related later on.
Okay.
But if you are talking about summary of the case, this is basic one. That is the foundation one. What is his risk factor? Whereas the typically what we teach as per the technicality or the textbooks is that in the section of the history of presenting illness, you need to explain every aspect of the chief complaints you have mentioned in detail. Okay. So known hypertensive on medication, non-compliant does not become. So you can say that presented with this patient. Okay, fine.
So he presented with weakness in the left upper limb and lower limb since 4 days. He experienced sudden weakness of the left lower limb as he fell down when he was trying to get up from bed at 8 a.m. in the morning 4 days ago. He was also unable to wear and grip his slippers to the hospital. However, he could squat and get up from sitting position and had no difficulty in rolling over bed. He also developed weakness over his left upper limb and was unable to button his shirt. Around 4 hours later, the patient was unable to raise his hand above.
Okay. History wise, you said sudden. What do you mean by sudden weakness?
So acute onset. It wasn't gradual.
Acute onset. That did he note the time of onset of weakness or when he got up in the morning, he noticed the weakness?
He got up in the morning and he noticed.
So that we cannot say how many hours before he had developed weakness. We can only say that here I need you to explain or everyone to understand that there is something called as wake up, the neurologic deficit occurring noticed while getting up in the morning. In the pretext of the stroke, we call it as a wake up stroke. That means patient has gone to the bed comfortably, has walked to the bed, had a comfortable sleep. Maybe he would have got up in the midnight for the urination and he had gone back to the bed. But when he got up in the morning, he found that, he noticed that his upper limb and lower limb are not moving like the left side or right side, whatever it is. Okay. And what is the level of weakness? What is the level of inability? He was able to lift the legs, but he was unable to stand, or he was able to lift the upper limb, or he was whatever the extent of weakness also. some patient may have such patient wake up strokes usually will have inability to move the left side of the body, including upper limb, lower limb, and even the 43 during deep sleep, did not give any significant warning signs, it has produced neurological deficit. So that is typically explained as a wake-up stroke. Okay. That was 4 days ago prior to your examination, isn't it?
Yes.
And you have said further in the last line, around 4 hours later, patient was unable to raise the hand above. That means that what I understand is that when he noticed, he was able to raise the hand, but later on it progressed. So it was a progressive weakness. Yes. He noted some kind of mild weakness in left upper limb, left lower limb, and progressed further to the maximum progression was up to 4 hours after the knowing of his knowledge. That is after getting up from the in the morning, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay, fine. And initially you have said, however, he is unusual, that indicates that his upper limb weakness is more than the lower limb. Do you agree or not by history? Your history, and he was unable to wear and grip his slippers to the hospital. That is, when was it? After 4 hours, he has reached your hospital late.
Yes.
Not in the morning. Isn't it?
Yes.
So these kind of preferential weakness, we talk in some other conditions, not in such conditions. We can say that patient was unable to move his limbs while supine, he was unable to flex it. Unable to extend it on his own. He was not able to move to sidewards. I don't think that there are some situations where the upper limb, he is not able to lift. But lower limb, he will be able to move and he will be able to walk, he will be able to squat. There are some conditions, we'll come back to that later. But these histories are very important. Asymmetrical, what you are highlighting is asymmetrical weakness. But your examination finding something different, that's why I'm highlighting. Okay. Now, if it were to be uniform weakness, you need to mention that you've got uniform weakness in the both upper and lower limb. Okay. Now, as per your history, it's asymmetric weakness. Now, he also developed his weakness of the left upper limb. Okay. Anything else? So, you have told us about the weakness of the left upper limb and left lower limb. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Significance of the handed. Somebody is asking significant handedness. Okay. Right-handed or left-handed. We all know that everyone with right-handed will have the dominant left hemisphere. So, whereas even left-handed people, about 70 to 80% of them will be left-handed dominant, so not much difference. Can we comment on the distal muscles are weak but proximal? Yes, you can talk about distal muscles and proximal muscle. I will tell you what is the pyramidal distribution of weakness. In a pyramidal weakness, upper limb, the flexors will be more stronger than the extensors. Whereas in the lower limb, the extensor will be more stronger than the flexors. But it is not something like distal more than proximal. No. Pyramidal weakness, upper limb, distal muscle is more weak. Upper limb, proximal muscle will be more weak. So in your history, you have said patient is able to get up from squatting position, which includes proximal muscle. So that is not, maybe there will be some, because I am not able to talk to the patient, that history does not go to your diagnosis. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Okay. Now, if somebody has got lower limb, does have got only upper limb weakness and stirring of feet, lower limb is minimally weak, still able to walk, able to get up from squatting position, all those things, it indicates a specific area of the brain is involved. I'll come back to this later. Okay. So that is the inference. Yes, somebody is answering. Very good. ACA. Okay. Now, we'll go on to the next slide. Yes.
The weakness was more marked in the left upper limb in comparison to the left lower limb.
Okay, this is what I want you to highlight. The moment you say more marked on the left upper limb than the lower limb, it always indicates it's a preferential site. Some part of the brain which involves the upper limb more is involved. Lower limb is less involved. That is very classical in the MCA territory.
MCA
territory, but not in the ACA territory. ACA territory will have lower limb weakness moved to the upper
limb. More than upper.
Fine.
He also complains of slurring of speech since 4 days, sudden onset and gradually progressing.
Now, again, did you note that when did the, did you get the details? Every minute thing, neurological system, the very, very, very important thing is what is the onset, what is the progression, what are the associated symptoms? Very essential to know that to localize the lesion. We'll come back to that later. Okay, now, okay, yes, go ahead.
This is associated with drooling of saliva and deviation of the angle of mouth towards the right while speaking, eating and showing teeth. He was then brought to Cohen's Teaching Hospital.
What does that mean if the deviation of the angle of mouth to the right side?
The facial nerve is involved.
It just indicates that left-sided facial muscle weakness. Okay, fine.
He was then brought to Cohen's Teaching Hospital at 2 p.m. on the same day.
That's what I wanted to highlight. You noted the weakness at 8 a.m. when he got up. So he gets up at 8 a.m. agricultural labor.
Yes.
Again, questionable. Okay. Agricultural labor, especially in Madikeri and all places, will get up quite early. They go to the field quite early. Okay. That is one thing. And he has reached after 8 hours. And was it progressive from the onset? Of course, at some point you have said it is a progressive weakness. At the morning, it was not so severe. As the day progressed, it increased. Okay, fine. And then?
Then he is improving, sir, and he is on physiotherapy.
Now, there are contradictory points. Second line, second paragraph, you said gradually progressing. And the last paragraph, you are saying it is improving. Gradually progressing, slurring or disease? I didn't get that.
The slurring was gradually progressing, and then now he has been improving after he came to the hospital since 4 days.
Okay. So it is not, it's everything, you know, hours, no? Few hours. From the onset, did it increase slurring of speech?
Yes,
was it,
sir.
Slurring of speech or any other speech disturbance was there?
No, only slurring of speech. He couldn't.
So what do you understand by that? Slurring of speech?
Can be dysphagia or dysarthria.
Dysphagia.
Dysphasia.
Dysphasia. Why do you say dysphasia? There is no history to say the dysphasia. So just said slurring of speech. So always it tells us about dysarthria. If there is some speech and language defect, he is unable to understand. He is unable to speak properly. He is not able to recognize the article. Something like that. That may indicate
dysphasia
or some kind of dysphasia or something like that. Okay. Milder degree. Typically, they are all called as aphasia. You see, speech and language defect. Defect in the speech and language. That means when we are not able to understand others' word or commands, that is comprehension, or unable to process those and produce the words, or unable to read, unable to write. Any one of them, abnormal of any one of them, of the four component, or at least simple term, unable to communicate in day-to-day function. That is also good enough. They're all quantified to be called as dysaphasia. If it's mild form, they may be called as dysarthria. Yes. Dysphasia. Okay, fine. So that improving, what do you mean by improving? Simply improving is not enough. After how many hours after the hospitalization or the onset of symptom did he start improving his symptom? That means he was unable to lift it initially, but at what, after how many hours interval did he start improving? What is the importance of that? And what is the current status? Now it is almost 4 days now, 4 or 5 days now.
Yes, sir. 4 days.
4 days. Now what is the importance of that? Improving, simple improvement is not enough. In a sense, I want you to tell that, sir, when he came, he was unable to move the left upper limb, slightest movement or very slight movement or lateral movement was possible. But now he's after the therapy, he is able to move the upper limb, or he's able to make some grips, be able to button up or something, some action activity we need to tell. Similarly, left lower limb, he was unable to walk, hold a slipper. Now he's able to do that. He's able to walk. And within 24 hours after hospitalization, the patient become perfectly fine, sir. He is walking around. What does it mean?
Yeah, it is a transient.
That may be a transient neurological deficit. Or if he has improved drastically, markedly over 3-4 days, within a week, he's totally not at 1 week now. So within two days, he will become perfectly fine. It may be reversible neurological deficit. Okay. So we need to tell what is the amount of improvement in his functional deficit or functional defect he had. So you have to mention that. Okay. Fine. The simple term of improving is, okay.
So there's no history of loss of sensation, pain or burning sensation. There's no history of change in smell sensation, double vision, appearance of black spots, loss of vision, reduction in vision field, loss of sensation on face, drooping of eyelids, giddiness, vertigo, tinnitus, reduced hearing, difficulty in swallowing, nasal regurgitation, or drooping of shoulders. There's no history of urinary or fecal incontinence.
Okay, now before that, I would like to answer some questions in the chat box. Tejas Babu, sir, can preferentially lower limb weakness be seen in pulmonary fibrosis, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis? Yes, I do not know. Technically, I do not know why pulmonary fibrosis should produce preferential lower limb weakness. Okay, that is my answer. Now, can we differentiate? If the rapid resolution of a weakness starts within few hours of weakness, patient starts improving, that usually indicates embolic stroke. Okay? Or a very small lacunar infarcts, which may resolve. Whereas thrombotic strokes are usually larger ones. They do not start resolving within few hours or few days. It takes some time. Okay? You have told about loss of sensation. What sensation did you ask? Why did you ask about loss of sensation?
So to see if there's any sensory system involvement, if there's any sensory loss.
So to say that there is no sensory involvement. Why did you talk about burning sensation? I mean, okay, history of smell sensation.
So olfactory.
I don't think that those are the important relevant history to localize a case of acute neurological deficit. That is all to say that cranial nerve involvement, but in history, what is relevant to your case is double vision, that is diplopia, seeing of two things, double vision, double images, and vertigo, maybe tinnitus sometimes, difficulty in swallowing, nasal regurgitation, even all other things which are not relevant to the case. Of course, urinary incontinence, fecal incontinence are relevant. Okay, I don't say that those are all absolutely not relevant, but in the given case, it may not be relevant. I'll come back to that a little later. Okay. Fine. Significant of appearance of black spots. Is it just pulling the legs? I do not know. Significant of appearance of black spots where? Shanta, Satish to everyone. No, I do not know. Significance of appearance of black spots. Where is the black spots? No.
Sir, in my
eye. In the eye, what black spot? It is not called as black spots. It is not black spot. Now, what we call is that sudden unilateral transient blindness, uniocular transient blindness. That is called as
Pigax.
That is indicative. The moment you get that, only one diagnosis for you. It is in a stroke. It is not TAA. TAA is okay. So it can occur. Embolic TA can occur, but if it is a stroke, it is indicative of internal carotid artery occlusion. Okay, proximal stroke, they will have dense hemiplegia. Okay, so that is ophthalmic artery, a branch of internal carotid artery. Okay. So that is amaurosis pigax. Okay, fine. Yes.
So there's no history of loss of consciousness, no history of loss of balance, tremors, or swaying while walking. There's no history of altered sensorium, behavioral abnormalities. There's no history of involuntary movements or seizures. No history of headache, nausea, vomiting. There's no history of fever. There's no history of head or spine trauma. There's no history of chest pain, breathlessness, palpitations, swelling of legs.
Okay, all those things are fine. Why do you want to ask about loss of consciousness?
So, to rule out, like, usually hemorrhagic stroke has... Okay,
it is not only hemorrhagic, most commonly in hemorrhagic stroke, like severe subarachnoid hemorrhage or large intraparenchymal hemorrhage manifests with loss of consciousness. Even in a large MCA stroke, or IC stroke, the patient may lose consciousness, or even brainstem stroke for that matter can lose the consciousness. Loss of balance.
So cerebellar involvement.
Cerebellar, good. Swaying while walking for same. Okay, tremors, altered sensory. So altered sensorium behavioral abnormality, again, cortic. To indicate a cortical involvement.
It's not
involuntary movement or seizures. Yes, again, it indicative of cortical involvement. Headache, nausea, vomiting.
Raised intracranial pressure.
Raised again. Acutely in stroke, it occurs in a hemorrhage. Hemorrhagic stroke indicates severe. Pain and burning sensation can be... Okay, fine. Wash basin sign. We are not talking about wash basin sign in this thing. That is a very typical thing in the peripheral neuropathy or spinal lesion. Somebody is asking question in the chat box regarding pain, burning sensation. So that is always, you need to know what is the distribution of the pain, what is the distribution of burning sensation. Sometimes it may be just radiculopathy, a shooting radicular pain in the distribution of the root. Sometimes it may be tract pain, like the tract pain is a dull, ill-localized, not localized pain of a particular area. So such conditions you need to talk about chordal lesion or myelopathy. Okay. Wash basin sign or wash basin phenomena is that when your posterior columns are not carrying the proprioception, when you are standing on the feet and when you're washing the face in the wash basin, know that our equilibrium or balance is maintained by the several auditory audition, that is the vestibulocochlear nerve. Second thing is vision contact, your orientation, and third thing is proprioception from the your sole, that is carried by the thick nerve fibers and to the posterior column. Suppose the patient has got significant peripheral neuropathy or posterior column involvement, like in compressive myelopathy, some of the non-compressive myelopathy like subacute combined degeneration or some degenerative condition. In such case, the moment patient, you know, to wash the face, you need to close your eyelids. The moment you close eyelids, your visual cue is lost and patient falls. So falling on closer of the eyelid while washing or taking head bath, such thing is called as wash basin phenomena, always indicative of significant peripheral neuropathy or posterior column involvement. Anyway, it is not relevant to this case. We have just, because of the questions, I have just informed it. Now, why did you talk about the fever?
So any infectious causes, maybe meningitis.
Infectious cause, head, spine trauma, palpitations, breathlessness, swelling of legs.
So embolia, any cardiac origin of
cardiac
embolia.
Cardiac, to find out whether it could be an embolic source. Good. Yes.
Coming to the past history, there's no history of similar complaints in the past. A known hypertensive since 5 years and on treatment with poor adherence. No history of transient ischemic attack. Not a known case of diabetes mellitus, bronchial asthma, COPD, tuberculosis, ischemic heart disease, rheumatic heart disease, bleeding or clotting disorders, epileptic disorder, or peripheral vascular disease. No history of prior surgeries, no known allergy.
Why did you ask about TIA?
Sir, because it's a risk factor, like previous TIA.
Okay, so any person who had a transient ischemic attack, the chance of him developing major stroke, TIA is a minor stroke. It is defined as a transient focal neurologic deficit which resolves within 24 hours without a residual damage. That means many of the minor strokes, when you do the imaging, there may be lacunar infarcts, but they recover. They are currently not considered as a TIAs. They are all called as infarction only, minor stroke only. But there should be no residual damage on imaging. That is an additional criteria now. Okay. So such patients who had a TIA, there is a sevenfold increase in the chance of developing major strokes. Okay, fine. So all other things I agree, no issue. We'll go ahead.
So he's on medication for hypertension, particularly which are unknown, since 5 years with poor compliance. There's no history of use of anticoagulants of any cause. No history of use of alternate medicines or medicines without prescription.
Good, okay. Fine.
So he consumes mixed diet and has normal appetite. Performs daily chores without assistance. He sleeps adequately and has regular bowel and bladder habits. History of smoking BD since 30 years, 12 BDs per day. history of ethanol consumption, that is brandy, since 20 years, 90 ml per day.
Now, whenever the patient says 12 BD, 30 BD, all those things, you should be extra cautious. You need to re-question the quantity of smoking, okay? So it's very unlikely. Okay, anyway, it's okay. So that's good enough. So the two very, 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 very significant risk factor for the development of the stroke or atherosclerosis or the whatever you call the thrombotic events are the smoking, whether BD or cigarette or tobacco, whatever it is, and hypertension. Those are the two strong risk factors. In addition to that, our patient, gentleman, is nearing 70 years, male. Two unmodifiable risk factors and two modifiable risk factors. And isn't it? So I got a very high chance of developing a thrombotic event. By history, there are no risk factors for the development of the hemorrhage. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
No. He has got a strong risk factor for development of hemorrhage. Hypertension and advancing age are the two very important risk factors for developing hemorrhage also. Okay. But there are no factors to suggest embolic phenomena because there is no palpitation or cardiac failure or something like that. Okay, fine.
So he lives with his wife and his daughter and son live separately. His brother was a hypertensive and died of myocardial infarction 5 years ago at the age of 63 years.
Okay, now the living with the wife, son and daughters live separately is not relevant here. I don't think that is relevant here. But his brother, that is a sibling, had a significant cardiovascular event or risk factors for a cardiovascular event or thrombotic event is very significant. Whether his wife had stroke or his, that is not very significant. Okay, fine. Fine.
The hypertensive gentleman, elderly gentleman, presents with acute neurological deficit in the form of weakness of proximal and distal upper limbs and distal lower limbs of the left side associated with slurring of speech and deviation of angle of mouth towards the right. There's no other motor sensory deficits. Other cranial nerve, cerebellum, brainstem seem to be uninvolved. His mental function seem to be intact. From the history, I am thinking of a thrombotic stroke involving the posterior limb of the internal capsule.
Now, the history-wise, I am not very sure about this. You were finding or thinking of internal capsular stroke. What is the oddity? Internal capsule is the place where all cortical fibers, the pyramidal fibers, come and converge into a very small area, less than a centimeter area. If there is a stroke, there is no scope of asymmetry. It typically manifests as dense hemiplegia. That means upper limb weakness of pyramidal and lower limb weakness will be almost equal. You have said that there is a gross disparity to the upper limb weakness to the lower limb weakness. So, by history, I do not consider it to be capsular stroke. Okay, fine. So, I have some slides. If I think we have some time today. So, I thought I will just go for a few slides to describe what are the important things to, because the heading was given as a approach to motor weakness. Now, what is important? A patient will come, what do you mean by motor weakness? Inability to perform a motor act, inability to use the limb with the normal muscle power. Okay, so we need to localize the lesion. Which part of the nervous system deficit or the lesion is producing this weakness? That is, we typically call it, where is the lesion? So to know that, we need to know the anatomy of the motor pathway, right from the cortex, that is the layer 5, that is the bed cells or pyramidal cells, and then its fibers, axons, coming down till the anterior horn cell in the spinal cord. I'll come back to that. And then the motor fibers, second order fiber neurons from the anterior horn cells will go as the anterior root, narrow trunk, and so on, till the muscle. So if the defect in any of the circuit, right from the cortical cell to the myoneural junction, lesion anywhere can produce weakness, but distribution of weakness is more. So you need to know, find out where is the lesion. So I'll come back to that little later. Then you need to find out what is the type of weakness. Am I dealing with the UMN type of weakness by history, not on examination, by history, or element type of weakness? So in this patient, it has started all of a sudden, we will not be able to differentiate, because the moment he stands up, his knees buckles. But in some other conditions, like a compressive myelopathy, which is a little gradual course, we may be able to differentiate whether it's an element weakness. If somebody says that buckling of the knees, typically as I get up, I get difficult in getting up from squatting position, or the buckling of the knees or giving away feeling is very typical of element weakness. Whereas UMN weakness, patient with UMN weakness will typically have heavy feeling. They find it difficulty to bend the limbs at the joints, because along with the weakness in the UMN, there will be tone is also increased. That means agonist and antagonist, they are not coordinating. So they will have heaviness. They typically explain that the limbs are like log of wood. I'm not able to bend my knees, bend my upper limb. I'm not able to move my upper limb very. So it feels like a log of wood, heaviness. And even while walking, I cannot bend, flex my knees properly. I have to take a circumduction, or you can ask verbally, you can ask that, and you can find out whether it is UMN weakness or LMN weakness. And again, other things are like whether there is a marked thinning of the limbs. In LMN weakness, naturally of long duration, will have thinning of the limbs. And you can again ask the history of patient notice. Some intelligent patient will notice that fasciculations, they feel that something is moving under their skin. So that some intelligent patient will tell. So if those histories are available, that is very useful to differentiate by history, in the history level itself, to say that whether it is UMN or LMN. Okay. Then you need to find out what is the pattern of weakness. Whether it is only one limb is involved by the weakness, then it is called as monoplegia. One side of the one upper limb, one side of the upper limb and lower limb is involved, it is called as hemiplegia. Two lower limbs are involved, paraplegia, all four limbs, quadriplegia and diplegia, either two upper limbs and so on. Okay. So there are so many conditions, that is a pattern of weakness we need to tell. Now here in this case, you have mentioned it is a one-sided weakness, and you have mentioned that it is a hemiplegia or hemiparesis. The plegia is total weakness, paresis is a partial weakness. Okay, fine. Now, I know that you all have the good understanding. I just wanted to highlight a little more to emphasize, give the emphasis on that. Okay, fine. Differential diagnosis for the acute weakness. So you need to give what and why is the lesion. Now we have said where is the lesion, what is the type of weakness, what is the pattern of weakness. Then we need to give what are the possibilities, what could be the lesion, and why did the lesion occur. That usually pathology, etiopathogenesis. Now, in the current case, it may be infarction or hemorrhage, embolism, we have discussed. Like that, there are other conditions which can produce motor weakness, like demyelination, traumatic disruption, degeneration, tumor, and so on. Okay. Finally, you need to also to take, in this case, we have taken the history of hypertension, past TAE, and so on. The story, the history is very important. The onset, its progression, its the associated features, like we have discussed early, the hyamin functions or loss of consciousness, seizures, diplopia, nasal regurgitation, such history will help us to localize the lesion. In some patients, root pains will help you to. Some patients, the sensory deficit up to what some level may help you to localize. And in whatever the case, let it be a neurological case or cardiovascular case, I believe that 80% of the time you will arrive at a reasonable diagnosis at the end of the history. Then 10% you add upon by the doing your methodical examination. That's all it will add up. So without proper history, if you go to the examination, you may miss the etiopathogenesis. And finally, investigation will add up 5%, another 5%. And rest of the 5%, you may not be able to find in spite of all possible investigations. Okay. Now, this is what I was talking about. There are different lobes. There are, we all know, I'm not going to do the anatomy. Now, this area, precentral gyrus, is the typical motor area. In the motor area, we have entire convexity. The lateral convexity, a large area, is represented by the face area and tongue. And part is proximal to that, or near the vertex, is the leg area, that is the convexity, okay, around the sagittal plane. And then you have mean between the upper limb and trunk. So that is the orientation of the topographical orientation of the regions in the precentral gyrus. Exactly, postcentral gyrus, the same areas will be represented by the sensory areas. Okay, fine. Now, if you say that you have a patient with the asymmetric weakness, it may be upper limb and slurring of speech. It may be this area is involved. If you say dense left upper limb, left lower limb, and speech difficulty, it may be entire area of the cortex to produce that dense thing. The entire area of the cortex should be involved. By the time when the entire cortex is involved, the patient will usually tend to develop edema, increase nerve pressure, and lose consciousness. Okay, fine. So this is one part which I wanted to know. But this is another slide which I have told you already, that the pyramidal, all the pink fibers which I have depicted, it is not from my own. It has been taken from some book or some slides. I do not remember exactly. The pyramidal cells will start from the layer 5 bed cells, and they are the largest cells. Okay, and they all come from the, I'll come back to the subcortical. Somebody is asking how to differentiate all those things, the corticals. That's what I'm coming up now. Now this is the all the areas of the whatever the previously shown, the lower limb area, upper limb area, so all those things, all the fibers will radiate like this fan-like fashion, axons of those bed cells. They're called as this radiation is called as coronoradiata, and they all converge to a very small area into the posterior, anterior two-thirds of the posterior limb of the internal capsule, that between the thalamus and basal ganglia, ganglio-thalamic area, in between that a small strip, and part will also come to the genome. Okay, so that is this area, this is the thalamus and basal ganglia, and this area, and from there the fibers come down. Now what does this fiber contain? From the cortex, they contain two sets of fibers. One set of the fiber is corticobulbar fiber, that is the fibers intended to connect the first order neurons coming till the nucleus of the, or the neurons of the cranial nerves. They call as corticobulbar fibers. Almost all cortical bulbar fibers have got bilateral representation. That means, so that is what it is being shown here. The cranial nucleus in the midbrain, pons, and medulla have got bilateral connections, except upper half of the seventh cranial nerve. Or lower half of the seventh cranial nerve. Upper half got bilateral, whereas lower half. So that is the issue. Now the corticobulbar fibers will end there, whereas corticospinal fibers will pass through the all these brainstem structures, and they decussate. 80 to 85% of fibers will decussate at the lower medulla, called as pyramid. Medulla oblonga, the posterior aspect. And from the medulla, they continue as the spinal cord in the lateral columns, corticospinal tract. And they all, whatever the fibers intended for the cervical level, they will end at this cervical level. They give the connection, second order neuron, to the anterior horn cells. They synapse with the anterior horn cells. Okay, from the, so on, till the coccygeal levels, we have 8 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral, and 2 coccygeal segments, spinal segments. So all these areas, these fibers and axons of the bed cells will go on connecting. From there, what happens? As they synapse from the corticospinal tract to the anterior horn cell, the second order neurons will start from there. They pass on the anterior ramus, they call as motor nerve root, ventral root. They also join the posterior dorsal root. They become a nerve root. They emerge out from the spinal foramina. From there, in the cervical, we know that multiple roots coalesce together to form a brachial plexus. Yes, and then those break up with several cords and roots, and they several nerves. They're all mixed nerves. They contain both efferent and efferent nerves. They all come, and they finally deliver to the or synapse with the myoneural junction, and they stimulate the muscle across the myoneural junction. Okay, this is what is the total pyramidal system or the pyramidal or motor system, motor pathway, right from the bed cells. Now, the first odd neuron starting in the bed cell, goes up to the spinal cord, terminal level or cortical level. And beyond that, from the, cranial and the nucleus, they're called as second odd neurons, they're LMN. So up to the anterior horn cells or cranial nerve nuclei, they're all first order neuron. And from the cranial nerve neurons or this anterior horn cell, they're all called as second order neurons. Now, any deficit in the second order neurons also will produce motor weakness. Now, that becomes LMN weakness. Any interruption in the first order neuron circuit becomes a upper motor neuron weakness. Okay. So that is a okay. Then history in case of motor weakness, you need to take little more history. What are the history to be taken? Pattern, we have already said, whether paresis or plagia, we have already said that. So it is important to find out weakness. Sometimes I give the example, a person who comes with the upper limb, right upper limb weakness, small area, right upper limb weakness. It may be due to a brachial plexus lesion. It may be due to the cervical nerve root lesion. It may be due to the antehonsillar lesion. It may be due to individual nerve lesion, small focal weakness. Now they all become the LMN weakness. If it is beyond that, if it is spinal cord, it cannot manifest only with the upper limb weakness. It should always involve the lower limb as well. Okay, so that part will speak. If it is brainstem, again, it cannot manifest only with the upper limb weakness. The next possibility for the upper limb weakness is the cortex. Either LMN from the anterior horn cells downwards, or it should be in the cortex involving a very small area of the cortical area representing the upper limb area. So those are the only two possibilities, UMN versus LMN. But in between, that cannot not possible. So you need to able to say that. Then the onset, whether it's sudden onset, very rapid onset, like thunderclap. Somebody says that I had few minutes back, I was fine. Suddenly I felt this. The sudden thunderclap like or the lightning like speed that usually occurs in the, if it is with headache, somebody has answered subarachnoid hemorrhage, good. And demyelination also can produce that. Demyelination, subarachnoid hemorrhage, demyelination, and embolic stroke. Embolus, a small clot which goes from that and dislodges, occur suddenly within few minutes, they can develop. So demyelination, the subarachnoid hemorrhage, rupture of the anything, hemorrhagic stroke, sudden onset, demyelinating stroke, sudden onset, or disruption, trauma. Those are the instantaneous, whereas even if it's embolic, it takes some time, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, sometimes, okay, some hours. So the gradual over minutes, hours, days, months, that is also important. Then course, after the onset, whether the deficit is static, progressive, how rapidly it progressed, or it has regressed, it has grown to some extent, and again, it has started regressing, or it is fluctuating. Fluctuating weakness very typically indicates mineral junction problem. Like there are two conditions, fluctuating weakness. One is myasthenia gravis, fluctuating weakness. Morning I was perfectly fine. Evening I get significant, my things drop from my hand. So significant weakness. It may be universal, it may be unilateral, something like that. So fluctuating weakness always tells you about myasthenia and Eaton-Lambert. Both are related to neuromuscular junction problem. Now, what are they associated? Of course, Aishwarya has taken the good history, the speech, level of consciousness, speech. If the speech area is involved, you need to say that, you need to give little more elaboration on the speech, whether he's able to understand our conversation or he's not able to understand. If he's unable to understand our conversation, it may be receptive or posterior Wernicke's encephalopathy. Wernicke's aphasia. Now, the conscious level, you need to talk again whether he had lost consciousness with the onset of the disease or several hours after. That is also important. Not just loss of consciousness. If somebody has lost consciousness from the onset itself, it always indicates hemorrhage or subarachnoid hemorrhage. If patient has developed some weakness and later he developed the loss of consciousness, second day, third day, patient may lose consciousness. That is because of the cerebral edema. initially started as a thrombotic stroke. There's something called as vasogenic edema, cerebral edema, cytotoxic edema. There's so many kinds of edema flooding into the, leaking into the brain substance, increasing tension so that can produce coning and produce loss of consciousness on second, third day. So the process may be different at the onset of consciousness. Headache at the before the onset of weakness, again, always indicate hypertension for the hypertensive stroke or SO, increase HOL, vomiting, seizure, everything. All those things suggest very increased intracranial tension. Okay. Abnormal movement, imbalance, sensory, I think we have discussed all those things. Now, the significance of diplopia. In a patient with the, this kind of patient coming with the weakness of one side of the body and diplopia, we know that diplopia is because of the malalignment of the eyeballs. Normally, our eyeballs are in a common axis. They are all controlled by the extraocular muscles. There are several extraocular muscles. Third nerve supplies.
All these
extraocular muscles are supplied by the third, fourth, and sixth nerve. Okay, four recti and two oblique. Okay, now all these things. If there is any nerve or any muscle problem, if they malalign, they can produce diplopia. So if it is a cortical lesion, they will not manifest with the diplopia or any of these cranial nerve symptoms. Why? Because even if it is one cortex or the above the brainstem, if there is a lesion, the nuclei will be supplied by the opposite cortex, bilateral manifestation. So the none of the cranial nerves will be involved in the above the midbrain lesion. If it is the brainstem, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
There is some problem. I'll again restart.
No problem.
You're audible, sir.
Okay, because some notice came. Now, if the thing I was telling about
brainstem.
We know that third, fourth nerve nucleus are in the midbrain. If there is a midbrain lesion. That
okay. Now I think we have asked about, we are talking about diplopia and other thing, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that was the brainstem to note. And also you need to ask about the any risk factors that we have done in this case. All the risk factors, the gender, the we know by the history, the gender and the hypertension, diabetes, dyslipidemia, family, many things. Okay. And past events like TAA, which you had taken this thing. Hello, am I audible or?
Yes, sir.
Audible, sir. Everyone. Okay. Now, the early morning thrombotic stroke, because of course, there are so many theories put forward that I'll tell you why it is a wake up stroke way. This does not onset. When we are awake, the patient can feel that it is a small weakness also, they can assume. But during the thrombotic process, as we all know that thrombotic process, once there is a fissuring, it takes time to build up the thrombus. Okay, they build up the thrombus or plug to totally occlude. It may take some time, several hours. So if it has occurred at the 3 a.m., by the time patient gets up, it is almost completed or major weakness would have. So you will not know when it has started. Now, why it occurs in the early morning, 3 a.m.? That is because circadian rhythm. Heterogeneity because of the various things, the thrombogenicity is quite high. Okay. The platelet activation is also quite more in the early morning hours. So somebody says audio is not clear.
Sir, could you please turn off the video, sir? If the net is poor, that happens. If video is turned off, then the audio
will come. I'll turn off I have turned off video. Yes. Now, audio is okay.
Yes, sir. Audio is clear, sir.
No. Okay. Anyway, now I have put this slide of this thing. So, by history, you should be able to deduce or at least tell the cross location and etiopathogenesis. Whether if it is UMN, is it cortical? Is it subcortical? Is it capsular? Is it midbrain, pons, medulla, spinal cord? Those are the reasons, those are the common sites to produce UMN abnormality, UMN weakness. Okay. Now, we all know by the history, we know that to produce, if it is cortical, that will produce may produce seizures or unconsciousness or some other high mental function abnormality like behavioral abnormality or aphasia, apraxias. Many of the high mental functions can be abnormal. Subcortex, especially in the intercostal, they are not associated with any other things commonly. Okay, they are pure motor strokes. Subcortical and other condition like thalamus, basal ganglia, they may be having multiple abnormal movement disorders or sensory problems. Midbrains, as we have explained already, there may be vision problem. Pons, we know that the pons, there are 6th nerve and 7th nerve nucleus, so they will have the localized. Is it my audio interacting or somebody else is?
No, sir. Somebody else is. Okay, muted, sir. Muted them.
Okay. Now in the pons. Now whatever said and done, we know that pyramid going down the below the medulla is crossing over from the one side to another side, isn't it? Decussating. So if it is a midbrain lesion or pontine lesion, they will have the ipsilateral, that is the side of the lesion. Side of the lesion means abnormal structure, abnormal disease structure, lesion. In the same side, ipsilateral side, they will have element type of cranial nerve palsy.
Whereas
on the opposite side in the limbs, they will have UMN type of weakness. So that becomes that is something called as cross hemiplegia. So if you have got a right-sided third nerve palsy by examination and left hemiplegia, that becomes midbrain lesion, Weber syndrome or midbrain lesion. Similarly, sixth nerve lesion on the one side and the opposite side, that is again cross hemiplegia, seventh nerve, so on. So that goes on like that. Okay. But it is not so typical in the medulla, because medulla we have the medial and lateral, the vascular supply is different. Lateral medulla, the pyramidal fibers will go on the medial part aspect, whereas lateral part will be separate. They all have the multiple cranial nuclei, cerebellar peduncles, and so on. So they typically manifest with no weakness, but there will be severe lower cranial palsies, nystagmus, sensory problems, so on. They are all called as lateral medulla. That is not in the scope of this discussion. I'm just highlighting that. So they typically, lateral medullary syndrome will not typically manifest the weakness, but they will manifest the lower cranial palsies, nystagmus, sensory deficits. Okay. In the spinal cord, all cranials will be fine, high mental function will be fine, but they will have a unilateral weakness or bilateral, depending upon the spinal cord per se. Many of the lesion will not affect only the motor fiber. They will also have the effect of the other ascending or descending fibers. So they will usually have other sensory or motor fibers, or at least the emerging nerve roots. So they will either have a radicular pain or radicular sensory deficit or tract deficit, spinothalamic tract or something like that will be involved. So there will be associations. Okay, fine. LMN, I have already explained you, Antrahorn cell will be pure motor. If the Antrahorn cell is diseased, there will be pure motor disease. Motor root, again, maybe pure root, plexus, all those things, there will be multiple combinations of the lesions will be there. Combinations of presentation will be there. Not only motor weakness, they will have sensory. So we know that individual nerves will have a specific pattern of the sensory picking up or sensory reception area. So along with the motor weakness, they will have this sensory weakness pertaining to the nerve distribution area. Root, every root has got a dermatomal representation for the sensory area. So if the root is involved, the particular root, motor root, will have specific sensation from specific area. So that combination will tell you that it is in root area, so on. Now coming to the pathology, we need to understand whether it's ischemia, hemorrhage, demyelination, tumor, trauma, so on. Okay. So it is not enough if you just say that. You also need to, by the history, you should say, what is the severity of the disease? Somebody has come with the weakness. What is the severity? How do you assess the severity? You have to assess what is the limitation of the activity of daily living. Now, whether he's able to carry out the weakness, that's all the various factors you can add into that. And whether it is life-threatening, if the disease process is life-threatening. All those things you have to highlight in the history. Of course, Aishwarya has done a good job and has mentioned many of the things. Okay, fine. We will come to this summary. So I will highlight this summary as like this. This elderly gentleman, a chronic smoker. You have missed out the chronic smoker in your summary. That is a risk factor. Hypertension on the irregular treatment, presented with the acute onset of weakness of left upper limb more than left lower limb, associated with the weakness of the left lower half of the face and slurring of the speech of 4 days duration, but currently non-progressive. That's what I understood that. Okay. He does not have any symptoms suggestive of involvement of hyoid function, grill nerves, brainstem, cerebellum, sensory system, or bowel and bladder involved. I consider having left-sided hemiplegia or hemiparesis. I could not assess by the history. Due to the completed stroke, what do you mean by completed stroke, Aishwarya?
It won't progress further. It has reached the maximum.
If the weakness has reached the maximum and it is not progressing more than 24 hours, that is called as completed stroke. So this is a case of complete, that is a history fact, isn't it? So you can tell it in the history itself. Completed stroke involving the right MCA territory, because I said MCA because by history your upper limb weakness was more than the lower limb, probably due to thrombotic infarction because it's a wake-up stroke, in the static or recovering course or phase, whatever it is. Okay, it is unlikely to be hemorrhagic or embolic stroke due to it is not a sudden in onset. We do not know when it did start. At the onset, he did not have headache, vomiting, convulsions, seizures, or any hyoid function abnormality. So it is unlikely to be hemorrhagic. Same, it is unlikely to be internal capsular by history because asymmetric weakness, difference between the gradient between the left upper limb and left lower limb. Unlikely to be brainstem stroke because of the no crossed field. He's got weakness of the left half of the face, lower half of the face on the same side of the weakness. That is usually in the UMN type of facial nerve weakness that we have just explained, that only lower half of the face will receive the connections from the one side. It will not have the bilateral. Okay, fine. So other differential diagnosis for the hemiparesis, other than the thrombosis, ischemia, hemorrhage, so-called cerebrovascular accident, it may be hemorrhage, subarachnoid hemorrhage, or subdural hematoma. Subdural hematoma or extradural hematoma, which are usually slow in onset. I'm unable to read the chat box. So I'll come back to the chat box once my computer starts. It is some process has happened. Okay. I'll come back to that questions on the chat box a little later. Demyelination also can manifest with the hemiplegia or weakness, motor weakness. Okay. Space occupying lesions like tumor, abscess, granulomas, all of them can present with the weakness of one side of the body or part of the body, whatever it is, but usually they're very gradually progressive. But sometimes suddenly they can aggravate, like for example, a tumor or a granuloma that suddenly get bleeding inside the lesion. Secondary hemorrhage inside the tumor is very common. So that such condition can produce sudden weakness of the one side. Don't forget about Dodd's palsy, post-ictal paralysis, a focal seizure, person who had a focal seizure may develop weakness for several hours after, lasting for several hours immediately after the postictal period. So that can manifest the motor weakness, isolated motor weakness. Sometimes complicated migraine also can manifest the motor weakness. Okay. And cervical myelopathy, that we have already discussed about these things.